to her demise. And you see here, they're at that moment beforehand, engaged in conversation, and he's speculating, he's thinking about the riddle, trying to come up with the right answer. She still thinks she's got it. So you see, poignantly at the end of his life, Aang almost has this sort of revised, redefined notion based on probably his own sense of his mortality, recasting his interpretation of this wonderfully moving subject matter. So we have that, and then if you turn around this wall, now you're standing as you turn around in the Dahash section. And again, the generational quality here, all of these people are in a way these successors of David and that tradition, which accounts for the sort of family resemblance in terms of the way in which line functions to define and denote the classicizing past. But our hemicycle, which was in its time considered the greatest work of art ever, really. I mean, it was really considered a very famous work of art, almost as iconic as the Mona Lisa is today. It's something that we treasure, and it was my ambition to try and get people to understand more particularly the way that even academic artists used all the new technology to diffuse their work. So you have repeatability through reproductive technology that didn't exist before, including lithography of this type, and then eventually photography. He is one of the first artists to be documented through photogravures in what is now a conventional catalogue prisonnier. So the way in which canny artists like Dahash would work with dealers, with goupil, to be able to diffuse their work worldwide and to make demand, to generate demand, is something that I wanted to get at because it's something that conjoins both academic and avant-garde artists during the 19th century and on beyond. So to give you a sense, though, of the transitions in scale, we included this very large blow-up of a preparatory sketch for transfer for the actual mural that you will find at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, which was the original commission for the hemicycle, and which you will still find in place. So you see the way in which the Chantilly version recorded in this reproductive print differs very subtly from our own version. This is actually a kind of process of evolution in the way the artist worked out the idea. So one of the complaints when this was first exhibited to the public was that you couldn't tell when you look at these two figures who the duelist was, because the figure of the Indian is turned in conversation with the harlequin figure. So there was some confusion as to the narrative. And so in this version, which was also done on commission, you can see in infrared photography, and maybe even in raking light, you can see it, that he has actually turned the head of the Indian. It used to be facing in that direction, and now it's facing in this direction. And wonderfully, by the time you get to this version, which is done afterwards, the composition is completely resolved, and now the Indian has his head facing in this direction. But you see how the narrative becomes clearer in that slight repositioning. So you have the artist actually responding directly to criticism and improving on his recipe as he produces several other versions. So Jérôme, and again, all the unfolding of this family, then leads you into a completely different arena, which is Barbizon's school of painting. And I hope you feel palpably the difference in the way these things look, in the degree of finish, and the sketchiness. And so this is really very much like a little mini version of the Musée d'Orsay itself, where you can experience academic French painting and avant-garde painting at the same time. Perfect, perfect teaching vehicle. I keep on telling everyone you know, if anyone you know is teaching the 19th century, this is where you're going to be. You might think that an artist who's known for his gestural brushwork, whose expressive temperament is supposedly attached to the way in which he applies pigment to canvas, the way that he wields color in his homage frequently to the great artists of the past, to Veronese, to Rubens, that he might not resort to repetition. Every seemingly spontaneous gesture can't be repeated, right? Well, he's just like anybody else. He's got a really big studio. He's a very popular guy. This is one of his most popular subject matters, Christ on the Sea of Galilee. And he does this over and over and over and over and over. I'm only showing you six in the end. The one from the Metropolitan is coming a little bit later. It'll go right over there. but he did actually more than 15 versions, and some of them with studio help. So in this gallery, we play a little game with you. This label will be different by this Friday, but I actually want you to be able to try and find the one that's been demoted to a student copy. So if you look, there are some laminate cards that are in the corner over there, and it prompts you through a series of photographic details to try and differentiate, to look very carefully and see the subtle differences between all of these different versions. So you know, of course, the import of this particular tale. You know, his disciples are freaking out because it's a storm and they think they're going to die and the boat is lurching. And of course, you see Christ, who's asleep calmly with his golden halo, signifying that he's clearly confident that all will be well. So it's a metaphor, it's a parable of Christian belief and the power of Christian belief. But if you study each and every one of these, it's delightful. It's really just like a director who keeps on rearranging his players on the stage to see what will work the best. So he's got this limited cast of characters, but each one of them is doing something slightly different in every different version. One of the really fascinating things when we installed last week was the way in which repetition visually works in this installation to affect you physically. So one thing that happened as soon as we hung all of these is that we started to feel sea legs. Because, you know, it's fun that way. Though, but painting is a very bodily art. It addresses the body, especially at this particular point in the tradition. It's still all about the body. And really the way in which you respond bodily to what you see is something that I think this installation really plays up. So moving right along, because I know you don't want to. So from the neoclassical to the romantic to the Barbizon, all in 15 minutes. So that was pretty good. But we are really, really thrilled to be able to show you this selection, including the wonderful masterpiece from Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. This is the most, I think, recognizable version of this very powerful subject matter, which when he painted it was taken, you know, alternately as a celebration of condemnation of the French government for misunderstanding the power of the peasantry, et cetera, et cetera. It does have an almost Soviet feel to it, but the strength of that striding figure is something that he came to very gradually. So here we have an instance where we can show you the artist working out a subject from its very earliest inception, and this painting is from Cardiff. And you can see it has a completely different format. It's actually quite slender. It's a little Japanesey. It probably is in some way inspired by Japanese ukiyo-e prints. You can find in Hiroshige figures that very much look like this one. And you see how that massive lurching cloud of black crows, that ominous note that really, it's very, very interestingly different from these other versions. And here we have, for the first time exhibited side by side, a little known version at the Carnegie in Pittsburgh. And it's always been curious to specialists as to what exactly this is, because you look at these two paintings, and of course, very resembling, but look at the surface, it's so much more thinly painted, and our specialist, Simon Kelly, has concluded that it probably was a studio copy directed by the master, probably in response to his gallerist's demands. And this, again, is one of the shared components for all of our artists. They do have a market, they do have gallerists, gallery owners who are trying to encourage them to try and meet market demand, and so repeatability is a part of everyday practice in life. But that doesn't stop this artist, Millet, from treating over and over again in this beautiful pastel medium the subject with a completely different sense of time of day, a completely different sense of delicacy in each variation. And of course ours, which is the best, is centered in the middle of that wall. But to give you a sense of that multimedia approach to a subject and the subtle ways in which he plays with his idea. So that heroic, monumental figure now translated into a much more delicate format with that beautiful landscape and that variation in atmosphere that seems to anticipate Impressionism. One of his most popular subjects again during his lifetime, and we're thrilled to be able to reunite our later version with the prime version from the Musée des Augustins Toulouse. So, you know, again, I can't tell you how rewarding it is for me to see all these things come together, because there was a lot of labor that went into getting the loans. And the museum in Toulouse, my colleagues there were very supportive from the very beginning, and they actually had this painting cleaned, which which was very kind of him because it's luminous now. It was a little bit disfigured by varnish before, and now it's just radiating its depth and its complete absorption of you into its loveliness. And then you see how different our version is, actually, which you might even consider a variant and not a reduced replica. These are all funny terms that they used in the 19th century that art historians throw around: copy, replica, variation. You know, these are things that we address in the intro panel as well. But what's very curious, again, is this little-known version, which is very close, in fact, in all its particulars, to the version in Toulouse. It's from a private collection in St. Louis. These have never been exhibited together before. And again, it's one of those instances where we had the opportunity, our conservator, Eric Gordon, was able to study all of them very closely in his studio, and he agrees with Simon Kelly, our Barbizon painting specialist, but it, again, it's probably a studio copy produced under the direction of Coro by student. But just a beautiful and fun exercise to compare them again and understand how different the poetry is in ours versus these others. This is obviously where we find the Monet Virtual Gallery, and this is one of the very exciting, innovative parts of this installation. I don't think anybody else has ever done this before. When I approached Joan Friedman, she was very enthusiastic about harnessing her staff's talents to produce this thing. And you know, what I'm after here is, you know, that pipe dream, referring to pipes again, ceci n'est pas une pipe, but well, one pipe dream for all curators is to reunite all of the grain stacks. Right? 1891, 15 grain stacks. Let's get them together. You know how hard that is? You know how hard it was for me to get Drake. Monet is one of the hottest artists still, much to my chagrin sometimes. The public cannot get enough of Monet. So what I'm doing here is not just gratuitously giving you Monet, but also giving you that sense of the incredible flexibility of the recipe of painting in series. Right? So now we're in a totally different mindset as opposed to those wonderful variations that Delacroix was producing. Here we are in the mindset of the Impressionist series, where there is no beginning, middle, or end. In other words, it doesn't make any sense to go up to a Monet grain stack and say, which one are you, one or eight? Right? The sequence is really not the point. The fact that it can be done over and over again with equally satisfying results is the genius of his recipe. But it's also the genius of his recipe that once it was exhibited in 1891, that series was dispersed. So we will never have that lovely, sublime moment of seeing them all together, except virtually. So this is one way in which you as a user hopefully can sit down, you actually play around with these things, choose your decor. We do have three virtual recreations of actual galleries that you should recognize. One our own Palazzo, one from the Cone Collection, and one from the glorious Kimmel Art Museum where I once worked as a fellow, and they were kind enough to give me permission to reproduce Louis Kahn's masterpiece. But it just shows you how different the paintings look in different decors. It gives you the option of picking different frames, and you can actually sequence them as you will. You become the curator. You get to make that wonderful decision. I like this one best. I'm putting it in the middle. I don't really like this one over here. I'd rather have the snow scenes all together. See? But you have to try to get the full effect. And believe me, once you start playing with it, it's really hard to stop playing with it. So we're hoping that it will be very popular. We did allow for the flat screen to show other users who are waiting other people's products, so it's a little bit more social. Again, what we're trying to do is avoid people just shuffling around with the audio tour, not talking to each other. This is meant to be a fun thing where you can sit together, where you can see other people's results and figure out whether or not you did a better job than somebody else. But all of these things will partially be posted on our website too, so people will have access to them again. But of course, the best thing is when you get the reproduction, the virtual reproduction in this format, this big, of this painting, and you realize what a difference there really still is and always will be between the authenticity of touch, the complexity of the surface, the absolutely ravishing painting which is unlined, the way in which Monet delivers in this scrumptious surface every single time. Another fascinating exercise when you look at the great Rouen cathedrals to note the difference in the way the facture is built up. So repeated but endlessly different, endlessly varied in the minutiae of the brushwork in the palette, in the choice of color, of hue. They're just deeply absorbing still works that I think will constantly appeal to our public and hopefully to you. But it is very interesting to know how different the surfaces are depending on conservation history, and this one has been lined, this one hasn't. And I ask you, at some point you'll be able to come and just look very carefully, because it's really a lot of pleasure to do so. Noticed it in Princeton at the University Art Museum. It's part of the permanent collection. Very, very similar to that tiny little male bather with the arms akimbo that belongs to a certain very famous artist, and that was included in the Cézanne and Provence show last summer. But here, again, a totally different type of repetition. These are not actually meant to be seen in series. These are just the necessary way in which Cézanne had to work. So hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these bathers, some of them more finished than others. Always an open question, is Cézanne finished? Is he happy? Did he want the canvas to show through? Or was it a throwaway? And in the compulsion of modern contemporary commercial galleries, every single scrap of paper that he ever produced has been preserved. So I've got out here just a copy of John Rewald's still classic Catalogue Raisonné to make that point. So you get a sense of how modern compulsion to preserve, to document visually through photography, the output of an artist over his entire lifetime alters the way that we perceive the object, the way that we understand the object, because there's a certain sense of false sequencing that occurs because of the Catalogue Raisonné, which is something that I wanted also to bring in. And then you have two color lithographs. You would never think that Cézanne, of all people, would even allow Voleur to make color lithographs, because you know lithography is a process that means the artist at some point is completely disengaged in his touch, in his actual making of the image, and it's given over to other artists who deal with the lithography stones. This is a process that's well explained by my dear friend and colleague up the street, Jay Fisher, who you will find featured on a video iPod clip, which is somewhere over here, somewhere over there. And I invite you to take a look at it, where he explains the entire process. But, you know, sort of a fascinating, again, the modernity of the 19th century. We already are at a point where artists are very conscious of market and of creating demand. So if you've done one bather that you're happy with, the Barnes Collection bather, then, you know, your dealer is going to say, well, I want this to be seen by more people. Will you let me make a color lithograph? And he does. So once that initial version in watercolor is done, the other lithographers take over, and now you have hundreds of them. So a very interesting part of the whole story, the narrative of modernity.
As you can see, I'm standing in front of the wall that declares Deja Vu, which is the new exhibit about to open at the Walters Art Gallery. And you'll notice that Lil is not with me. She's still back in the exhibit going through the tour and enjoying it very much, I'm sure. You should all come down to the Walters Gallery and watch Deja Vu.
So, and this is finally, I think, the two most eccentric versions of repetition in the show, which features, as you've just seen, 11 artists. Degas, and again, we're making good use of our own beautiful painting over here, Before the Race, and then reunited side by side, beautiful comparison with the version from the Clark in Williamstown. And, you know, very subtle variations, again, the way that you take this recipe, repeat it, and yet still produce a completely different effect in terms of touch. If you look at the opacity of the paint on this side, and look how thinly painted it is over here, the way in which he uses the wood grain to guide the composition, very, again, Japanese-y in a sense. And then wanting to show his very multimedia approach to making, right? So repetition is at the heart of his approach, where every single aspect of a given subject matter becomes a series of investigative works that produces a whole slew of other objects in their own right. So he used these originally wax sculptures to guide his own visual understanding of the way the horse's body looks in space as it's turning. And I've done this so that you can deliberately see the way that Muybridge prints, you know, stop-action photography and all of that, played into his literalization in three-dimensional form of the way that the horse looks rearing, for example, and the way that as you turn around the object, you get different silhouettes, which he then retranslates and repurposes in two-dimensional media, such as pastel, oil, and drawings. So that, in its own right, a section of repetition and the repetitiveness that is the creative process of a Degas. Here, I'm so proud of this because you never get to see this. This is 11 states of 21 in total etching. Leaving the back, probably not as familiar as maybe some of his other famous subjects, such as Mary Cassatt and the Louvre, but I thought, again, a wonderful way of showing how the medium itself, in this case, etching, with that etching plate, its reusability, the fact that each and every one of these is slightly different, creates a slightly different tonality, a slightly different sense of wiristic privacy, a sense of that body lurching, again, a reference as well to Muybridge and its ability to give you the way that the body moves in space, lurching as it does, she kind of heaves herself out of that tub. But every single one of these different, and in fact, I was a little sorry because my interactive for this section didn't come in yet, but it will this afternoon. And this is really something that, you'll laugh at me, but I had this fantasy of resurrecting the old magic slate. You remember the magic slate? And it occurred to me that the magic slate is actually kind of a crude parallel to the etching plate, because you lift up that little piece of plastic and it's gone. So what I did was I had it customized. This company in New York probably thinks I'm really, really nuts, but I actually had them make a template of the basic schematic composition of this etching, so that your magic slate comes equipped with that little template, and then you sit in front of one of these and you copy. And as you copy, you become aware of every little decision that he made, every little departure that he makes from the previous version, so you can recreate his own process. And then when you're done, you lift up the little plastic and it vanishes and you can start all over again. So anyway, I'm sorry that didn't arrive in time, but you can come back and play with it whenever you want. And then finally, Matisse, you can't leave out Matisse, and I thought a great coda to the exhibition. Wonderfully, Jeffrey Weiss, my good friend before he left for the DIA, he's one of the contributing authors to the catalog, who made these fantastic paintings available. And words sort of fail you at a certain point. But here, the reason that we have them exhibited with these photographs is to actually duplicate the way that Matisse himself exhibited these paintings during his own lifetime. So starting in about 1940, 1945, he got into this weird habit of actually photographing at the end of every workday the canvas to preserve a record of its genesis. And interestingly enough, when he was done with the painting, he actually chose to exhibit the finished work of art with the photographic states, as they're referred to. So we were able to borrow, in facsimile form, photographic states that correspond to these two works of art. And if you study them, the puzzling thing is that they actually mystify even more his artistic process. So even the simplest things that you think must be sort of straightforwardly transparent in terms of his making become very confusing. And we have in the video I clip the senior paintings conservator Ann Huntingsfold explaining this to you, but just to show you very briefly, if you look at the tiling before, you think how simple he just glue, he took the end of his brush and said, right? But then you look at the different photographic states and you begin to realize it took him five or six different approaches, different ways of using negative or positive pigment to designate that tile floor, and that he compulsively played with it until he arrived at this solution. So you may think, and I think this was exactly the myth that he was trying to combat, that he was the most facile graphic artist, that he whipped these things out in three strokes of a brush. And in fact, what he documents for you is the labor that went into every single one of his canvases. And, you know, of course, who was he trying to rival? Probably his good friend, Picasso. So you walk out the door and you end with these photographs, again, these detox states, photographic states of a work of art that he actually destroyed. And I just thought it was a lovely way alluding to all those works of art that no longer exist except in photographic form. So that interplay again between virtual reproduction and actual object, the authenticity of the actual object, but a more complex story, which is that the virtual does not destroy necessarily or undermine necessarily the authority of the original work of art. Sometimes it reinforces it. So I think I've probably taken too much of your time, but I'm happy to answer questions. And one other thing about the cell phone tour, you still can use the cell phone tour in these two galleries, so I invite you to try it. And let me know what you think. It's an experiment, but I really wanted to sound less like an audio tour, less stuffy, sorry. You need to want to know, it sounds good, but I thought it would be a little bit more interactive if people sounded less like robots and like they were just talking to you on your cell phone. And so we tried to give it casual ear to the whole time. But please do try it and let us know what you think. And I should say, Amanda's the one who actually managed the cell phone tour, and it was a real labor of love. And she's going to continue to record people as the show unfolds. We'd like to get visitor response, not just expert response, but real people responding to the audience and telling us what they think. So thank you very much for your attention. Enjoy.
Hello again, everybody. This is Jerry Getka, and we're here at the Walters Museum. And we're here with the curator of this new exhibit that's opening, Deja Vu. And I'll let you introduce yourself, because I always mess up names.
Oh, don't worry. Most people have problems with my name. But it's Ike Kong, and I'm curator of 18th and 19th century art here at the Walters.
And what exactly does a curator do?
Well, in this case, I actually select objects for exhibitions. I organize exhibitions. I also take care of our permanent collection. But this is a show that took almost 5 years to put together.
And this one specifically is interactive and lots of new technology. And why don't you explain a little bit about that?
Well, yeah, nowadays curators don't just write didactic wall text, don't just select objects.
Yes.
They, in fact, worry a great deal about their visitors. And one thing that we were determined to do was try and engage as many visitors at different learning levels as possible. So we've actually had collaborators produce multimedia interactives, including what we call the Monet Virtual Gallery, where you can manipulate 13 of the 15 original grain stacks by Monet, including the Marat video, which gives you a virtual life-size projection of the prime version of the Death of Marat in Brussels. So many different ways in which to learn.
And we've just been through a mini tour of that, and Lil is still back there trying to absorb all of the various types of art pieces and the interactive tools that you put in back there. Very, very nice. Very interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, this is Jerry Getka here at the Walters Art Gallery. And we're here for the press conference for the opening of the exhibit Deja Vu. Lil is still entrenched in the exhibit going through the repetition. Because it's repetition, I guess you have to see it several times. But we had a great time down here. We want to thank Gary Viken for the interview earlier and invite all of you to come down to the Walters and see Deja Vu.